about that. Jesus, save invite you to stand and just share with the church. Well, first, I just want to thank God that He speaks to us in different ways. One of the ways that He speaks to me is in dreams and songs and things like that. And, you know, sometimes you're like asking for direction, direction, direction. And all you need to do is just go to sleep. And He will make it very clear. And so I just thank God that, you know, with all the billions or what trillions, billions of people in the world, that He just knows exactly how to reach each and every one of us in the future. So I just thank God for that.
Amen.
Is there anything else?
Amen. This is more of a message. Michelle sent me another message this morning. It's on the highway. So she asked me, could I give it to y'all? And so it says, I'm sorry that I couldn't be there to celebrate this special time with you, but I would like everyone to know how special these two people are to me. Peggy and Kurt and Cross are two spiritual role models. In my time of troubles, they took me in, mentored, guided, and loved me. Today I am a woman, mother, and wife because of them. When I was in need, you two was there. When I was in trouble, you two was there. When I needed a mother, Peggy, you was there. When I needed a father, Kirkland Cross, you was there. I love you dearly from my heart. I will never forget what my times with you. I pray God's favor on you two special people. To your children, please always respect and honor your parents. Without them, you wouldn't be the people you are today. And to the church family, you all don't know how blessed you are to have the Cross family in your lives. Please continue to honor them and support them. Bless them as God blesses you. I celebrate you in my absence. God bless you.
John chapter 11, very familiar scripture. St. John chapter 11. I appreciate the hospitality for me and my wife. It's just been wonderful. Amen. We've been enjoying the fellowship. There's so many places you go, and yet it's not the case. But we thank God for that. Amen.
Amen.
And it should be easy for me to preach because not only will I preach anywhere, anytime, I'm amongst my family. Amen. Glory to God. So God is good. I want to talk to you from the book of John again, chapter 11. And I was trying to see and light up on some of the readings. So let's start at the 11th verse. These things said Jesus, and these things said he. And after that he said unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go. That I may awake him out of sleep. And the disciples said, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking rest in sleep. Then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is what?
Dead.
Done with. Dead. And I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent that ye may what?
Believe.
Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Let's just talk about Thomas. Then say Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may what? Die with him. Jesus didn't say nothing about dying. He said, I'm going. And wake him, Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad that for your sakes I was not there. Then when Jesus came and found that he had been, that he had lying in the grave 4 days already. How many days?
Four days.
Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off, and many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning his brother. Martha, as soon as she had heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha to Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, oh glory to God, somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's not over until God says it's over.
Uh-huh.
But that even now, whatsoever thou wilt, God will give it thee. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall what?
Rise again.
She wanted to be sure that he wasn't speaking over her head. She wanted to get down to the business. Now I see this boy dead, he's dead, and he's been dead for 4 days.
Uh-huh.
I believe what you said, so she's checking Jesus. And Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. So let's get it clear. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection. Good God Almighty.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh Lord, have mercy. In the light.
Yeah.
He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he what?
Live.
Then he asked and said, whosoever believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou what? This? She said to him, yeah, Lord, I believe. Now, this thing is a little bigger than me. It's bigger than me, Father. You're testing me. You're pushing me. I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which shall come into the world. She talked about him as being the Messiah. And then you come to find out that Jesus then, let's go all the way to the 34th verse for the sake of time. And he said, where have ye what? Laid him. They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. He said some of the Jews. And some of them said, could not this man? I skipped something, didn't I? Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. or Jezebel. Some of them said, could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should not have died?
All right.
In other words, if he had been here a little earlier, he could have took care of this. He could have cast out the sickness, he could have dealt with the illness, he could have caused and extended his life. But that job was too small for God's agenda.
Yeah.
Sometime in our lives, God wait and tarry a little while because the job is too small for his agenda.
All right.
We pray about it, we fast about it, we press our way into it, and God say, wait a minute, wait, wait, wait. He don't let no angels go loose. He don't let no healing go loose. He said, wait a while. It needs to be put on a step that only God can do this.
Yeah.
I come to talk to somebody here today. Hallelujah. Somebody that look like things are not turning out the way that you thought they would turn out. Things that are not going the way that you thought they would be going.
Right.
It looks like when you need God the most,
right,
he is the most silent.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Look like God get quiet when he's supposed to be talking and talking.
Yeah.
It look like he would be quiet.
Mm-hmm.
And for instance, if you're anything like me, God wakes you up at a time of the night that you think he should be asleep. God says, now that your mind is quiet, I can talk to you.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Hallelujah, somebody.
Hallelujah.
Something like that happened to me this morning. And anyway. Hallelujah, somebody. So God takes it. He says, listen, if you had been here, could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus therefore again groaned in himself coming to the grave. In other words, Jesus said, they don't know who I am. They don't know who I am. It's something about, I know Jesus way past us, we'll never be in his status. But it's something about a person of faith when you hear unbelief that it grieves your spirit.
All right.
Yeah.
When you hear people talk about God and the limitation, it grieves your spirit. It's nothing too hard. For God to
move.
Mm-hmm. Got my card again.
Yes.
Hallelujah. All right. We'll try again. There's nothing too hard for God to do.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, the top of that's how heaven is. Every time somebody sings a set praise towards God, all of heaven breaks out and shout, hallelujah.
Yeah.
I just want to join that heavenly host that every time we say something great about God, all of us go, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God is a great God.
Yes.
Amen. Therefore, groaned in himself, coming to the grave, and it was a cave, and a stone laid upon him. Amen. And Jesus said, what? Take away the stone.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's all right. I don't know what he was thinking. He said, show me the place. You got to walk through this Bible. He says, show me where he lay.
Uh-huh.
They are walking. He's showing them. He's taking them to that. They're taking Jesus to that place. When Jesus get there, it's a cave.
Uh-huh.
Not only is it a cave, but there's a stone rolled over the entrance of the cave.
Uh-huh.
It's an obstacle. It's something that is in the way that cannot be moved by itself. Jesus tells him, he said, listen, roll the stone away. He said, wait, 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 Lord. Listen, I told you, in 4 days, by now, he stinks. The body is beginning to decompose. By now, the situation is horrible. God, I don't know who I come to talk to. There's times that God, I don't know about you, that we wanted God to move faster than we wanted him to move. God was too slow for us. But God was on time for him. Somebody shout
hallelujah.
Somebody shout
hallelujah.
Jesus stayed away. When he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed away on purpose. Pray, fasted, got with God, seen the situation coming, and still ask God to do something, but yet the person or the thing died.
Yeah.
These are the kind of conditions that your only, your love for God will keep you safe. I know I'm in the right church. I'm in the meeting place. Listen, there are some things that were happening in your life that if it hadn't been for the previous stuff that God did to you, we're going to have some real people up in here. If it hadn't been, you would walk away. You would throw in the towel. You would say that this is too much for me. But because you love God, you say, where else can I go? Stay. Told you the marriage, I'm fast before you. I told you, looked like we wasn't going to make it. I talked to you about it. I fasted about it, Lord. Yes. I turned around 3 times. I put oil on my head. I got up early in the morning. I sowed my seed.
Yes.
Told you that it was about to put us out. I told my co-workers, I told everybody. I said, watch God make a way.
Yes.
Watch God do it. I testified of you. I knew that you wouldn't let me down, but yet you let this thing die. Good God of mine. Hallelujah. Praise God. Anybody ever had something to die?
Yes.
Come today just to talk to dreams and visions and circumstances and situations. Let you know that God hasn't forgotten about you.
Right.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I say God hasn't forgotten about you. God has you on his agenda. God knows where he's going to bring in his deliverance at. God hasn't forgotten about you. And even though you're going through, God has not forgotten about you.
Yes.
Now remember, y'all, if I go back just a little bit, they said, now, this is the one whom Jesus loved. Wait. This is the one whom Jesus loved. Lazarus is about to die. Let us wait. Walking with Jesus requires absolute obedience and faith in him because he don't do things like this. He's always about the will of his Father. He know that this situation, God is about to get some glory out of it. Somebody shout hallelujah. Let me tell you, not only can God keep you away from trouble, God can keep you in trouble. God say, I'm not bad enough only to let you keep you while you're in trouble, to keep you away from trouble, but that trouble can come, and I'll be right there in the middle. One time when I was going through some of the hardest parts of my life, all God would tell me is, I'm with you. I still wasn't getting it. He was trying to knock on my big old hard head. He would say, I'm with you, Trace. I said, Lord, deliver me. He said, I'm with you. I said, Lord, turn this situation around. He said, I'm with you. And if you got God with you, don't worry about it. I'm going to talk to somebody. God is bound to turn this thing around. That's what I'm going to talk about today, a supernatural turnaround. Supernaturally turn it around. You're going to go back. You're going to His sister said unto him, that was they said, Lord, by this time, 39 verse, by this time, he stayed. If we had been dead 4 days, Jesus said unto her, say I not unto thee? And if though this situation changed my view, and this situation hinders me, said I not unto you that if you would, if thou wouldest believe, that thou should see the glory of God.
Right.
Yeah.
I want to make this objection here. When we actually see God's glory, we don't know sometimes the process.
Yeah.
When we ask him to see God's glory, we ask him to see more of God. Mm. We don't know the process.
Yeah.
So, she said, you will see the glory of God. Then they took away the stone from the place where the babe was laid. Mm. Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me.
Yeah.
See that? Did you hear him say anything? Mm-hmm. Father, I thank thee. Mm-hmm. Thou hast heard me. Does that mean that he has some pre-dealings with this situation?
Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm.
He knows about this situation. Mm-hmm. God is so good.
Yes, he is.
God is so good. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Somebody just shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I told y'all already I love to praise God. Mm-hmm. Then he said, I know that thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I say it. And they may believe that thou hast sent me. Yeah. When he had thus spoken, he cried.
Yes.
First, you got to get the scenery, then I'm going to my respective place. We don't know how long Lazarus was sick. We did find out that Jesus wasn't far away.
Mm-hmm.
He could have been there on their time.
Right.
By God's divine timing, he waits.
Mm-hmm.
Lazarus then, that time, dies.
Mm-hmm.
People who are dependent upon him and call for him is put in limbo. Mm-hmm. He waited and let them wait. Mm-hmm. By the time he gets there now is the Jewish mourning session. Mm-hmm. They're mourning over the death of their loved one.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's 4 days. Lazarus has been dead now. Mm-hmm. Lazarus is in the grave. And the resurrection is standing on the outside the grave. That's what he said.
I am.
He told, I am the resurrection.
Uh-huh.
Now get this now. Resurrection comes standing. Now I don't know if it was a big graveyard like we have, but I can just imagine in my sanctified imagination that things start trembling. Because anytime you have a resurrection near a graveyard, the resurrection is by the graveyard. They got all kind of things shaking right now. And Jesus got to be very careful about what he's saying. So the Bible says he stood outside and said, look, take the stone off of this grave. God, somebody shout hallelujah. And he said he stood by it. And he said, Lazarus, it's good that he said that.
Words go and find him just like that. And all of a sudden he goes into Abraham's bosom.
trust God.
Yes.
Trust.
Yes.
Trust.
It's based upon a relationship.
Yes.
Yeah,
yeah.
Right.
Yes.
I know too much about it.
Yes.
If he wasn't going to come through here, then he shouldn't have came through there.
Yes.
His testimony pushes me to his faith.
Yes.
Yeah.
Power. 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 Power got born again January 10th, 1981, one February night. January night, at that time it was cold, and they had a rocky road in front of little 2028 Wyatt Street. And they had a wide rocky road at that time. And I got born again in January, went to job court in February, so that was a month later or so. But during that time, they had a little boy whose mother was on crack cocaine bad. She was a drug abuser. My mother took her in the house. My mother wasn't a godly woman either, but I had just got born again, new. And one of the things I said was, I'm born again, but I'm not going to be doing that shouting and that stuff. That's what the lady was talking about. That's what I said. Well, you can see. And I said, I'm not going to be doing all that. And so this little boy, he was dead in my heart. Mother. So we took him in. When we first took him in, he was so used to fast food that when we fed him wholesome food, he became ill.
Wow.
He didn't know what wholesome food was because his mother would take him and have him in the car while she doing her stuff with her drugs and what have you. It was a deplorable condition. And so we took him in. And during that time, the enemy attacked him. He got sick. He got real, real sick. And then with the sickness, I could tell, even though I was just born again, I could tell the sickness was not normal. I went in there, he woke me up one night, screaming to the top of his lungs. My white name was brown skin, and he had turned blushy, he had turned red. And I looked at him, every time he turned his head to the left, he just screamed like Pearl, like he'd seen something that was so horrible. It was a little bitty boy. And I took it. And I didn't know no scriptures or nothing, so I told him, I said, listen, God has angels. He said, just look at the face of the angel. He looks up, and starts smiling. When he looks up and starts smiling, I can't see what he's looking at. And so, my brother, everybody came up there, and they said, why is he glowing like that? They passed me. One of my brothers came and put his hand in front of his eyes. And when he put his hand in front of his eyes, he went into a convulsion. He started convulsing in my hand, and started jumping like that. His tongue going back. And so everybody stopped running. When he stopped convulsing, get the scenery now. He stopped convulsing in my hand. I stopped speaking in tongues. Mm-hmm. Now this, you don't understand my house. They don't know nothing about tongues. So here I got a boy that's convulsing in my hand. I'm speaking with tongues. I'll teach them what I'm doing. And they broke out running out the house. Hit it. I'm talking about supposed to be bold people. People there, and Rain got his mother. When Rain got his mother, his mother came in and she began to treat him with seasons. So she put the spoon down and she ran him and tried to cool his body temperature off in the bathtub. And I goes in there when I'm still speaking in tongues. And I said, listen, the Holy Spirit said, get him away from her. I just got born again. I said, Lord, that's his mother. I said, get him away from her. Before I could be obedient, the boy stood up straight, died, and hit the bottom of the bathtub like a hard ball of soap. Ooh. Boom! He lifted back up. Boom! He said, breath left his body. Holy Spirit speaks again. He said, get him away from her and pray for him. I said, get out of here. He said, Lord, I refuse to let the devil have this young soul. In Jesus' name, I command him to come back up. And I lift this hand up. And it was as a lightning bolt hit this hand, ran through my body, hit him and knocked him off of the bed of the tub, knocked him up. And he said, and come back to life. I'm trying to tell you that God will set you up with a testimony. some situation may be dead. No matter where you are, I came from the deepest of ghettos, my friend. I came from a place where, when I was a little boy, I was counting money, drug money, on the floor. Raised in the drug cartel, seeing somebody die and killed before I was 10 years old. Pieces of meat on the wall. Enemy thought that he had me good.
Yeah.
Became a drug warlord before I was 18. Before I was, oh, have mercy. Thank you for your grace.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Became a major drug dealer from New Orleans to Chicago. Lucas, y'all know Lucas, was in my living room. God had a plan. God said, not them. God said, that one there is my child. I didn't live that life up in the graveyard. But I've come to tell you that God stood outside the graveyard.
Witnessing to him about Jesus. So I got time for that.
say, you know why? Say, Rage, I was ignorant.
Yes.
I wasn't smart, I was ignorant. The people I seen that were supposed to be talking about Jesus was weak in their faith.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
Mm-hmm.
You put a bad stench on. So she said, listen, give your life to Jesus. I said, so Michelle, she said, give your life to Jesus. I said, give my life to Jesus. I said, my life is all I have. Trying to live this out, I'm going to have to check Jesus out when I get there. She said, well, Tracy, if you don't receive Jesus, you're going to hell.
Mm.
I said, what the hell? I said, girl, if I didn't know you was a children of a Christian, I'd take this pistol and get your knee. Now that I'm proud of, this is where you are. And I meant it. Anybody that knew me knew when I said something, I meant it. Just like I am now. And then she said, yeah, because you don't. You won't be born again. I said, born again? It's like Nicodemus. I said, what is being born again?
Mm-hmm.
I said, listen, what I'm going to do, I'm going to go over here next door and I'm going to drink some more of this liquor and I'm going to come smoke some more of this weed and come back. I'm going to let you tell me about Jesus. Because it's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
She did. I stayed a little too long. Some of you that came to this service said you wouldn't change it and stayed a little too long.
Amen.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
My supernatural turnaround.
Yeah.
I'm more the guy that I was to see the supernatural turnaround.
Tell your story,
preacher. Goes back there and Jesus walks up to me. He said, come to me. I said, Lord, I don't know these people. You know, people running around. Speaking in this funny language and all this. I'm a nice people, I'm very nice, but I don't know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, listen. I said, Lord, I give my life to you. He said, give me your life. I said, no. I said, listen, I don't know if I can live. I've never lived this kind of way before. He said, Lord, I will be with you. It's God, Jesus talking to me. Yeah, I said, Lord, I give up everything but my weed. I'm trying to get some. You got to understand, my weed and my relationship was my peace of mind. It was my natural way of trying to be calm and get some peace in the world. And so that meant a lot to me. I didn't realize I was talking to the Prince of Peace. He said, okay. Remember, come let us reason together.
Yeah.
Well, you know your sins be as red as scarlet. Yeah. Make it white as wool. Jesus can sit down and talk to you and reason with you. He said, okay, well, what does weed? I said, okay, Lord, it's grass. I said, for sure. I said, oh, you're about to tell me I can smoke this gun. God, you about to tell me. He said, well, who made the grass? I said, yes. Say, you did. I do. He's so wise. He said, okay, and in August, he said, I made the grass. Don't you think I'm able to make you feel better than grace?
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't understand the reason the one that's making it can do better.
Yes.
Uh-huh. So I say, yes. I say, but you're going to have to be with me. So I goes on. Tappy Davis said, listen.
Listen.
I said, Tappy Davis, y'all ain't Tappy Davis. Listen. I said, listen. So I goes on. In my house, you know, it's a normal thing. We get to eat, rose up, we had bunk beds, my brother and his girlfriend over there, I'm over here. And my brother, he starts rolling up in the morning. My heart stopped pumping fast, never did that before. I'm nervous to be, and my companion leads, calling. And my brother rolls it up, and I told God, I said, look, I ain't gonna be no hypocrite now. If you took this away from me, I ain't gonna be no hypocrite about this now. If I still like it. Seven years old, and people used to come from around town just to get me to roll for them. You look good. Selma, I can roll one hand in this girl. So I'm good. I mean, I've been doing this. And I goes, so ain't no breed supposed to be coming out. You're supposed to be in here. And so I goes in here. So I do it again. I do this to the third time. My brother looking at me. So I do it the third time, and the voice of God says to me, you can't put that in here now. I'm in here.
I
say, I ain't rain when I wear a 38. I sure ain't gonna run with Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So while I'm preaching, he offered me crack. You want some of this, preacher? I say, I'm already free, brother. You need what I got. Whom the sun set free is free indeed. Go taste and see that the Lord is good. I'm standing bold for Jesus just like I was in that world. Y'all got to listen to me.
Uh-huh.
See, that's what the church said. So, my friend got tired of it, you know, who I had to dream. I look and I wonder where he was. And I look and they hadn't snatched him. They brought him on the side of the car. I ran towards the side of the car because I knew it was about to go down. They had cranked up on me about to shoot him in the head. Mm-hmm. I said, no, don't kill him. I don't like how you're talking to me, right? I said, don't kill him. Don't worry about it. I'm all right with that. But God saved me. God will protect you.
Yes. Amen.
And all of a sudden, I'm praying. We have an hour of prayer. And the guy standing over us, the guy came and said, hey, first thing, y'all, first thing. He said, hey, you devils, look at y'all on your knees. That's why you're looking down. You're looking towards your father. He was supposed to be Yahweh, been Yahweh person. I knew the guy. He said, you come out here tomorrow, I'm going to shoot you. I said, I'll be out here tomorrow. The grass is going to be my carpet. The sky gonna be my ceiling, and the wind gonna be my air conditioner. Tomorrow, everybody meet down here.
Uh-huh.
I get out there the second day, everybody out there is selling turkey necks and everything. Are y'all listening to them? They selling turkey necks. They got turkey necks, broad potatoes, and all that going on, crawfish. And I said, look, I need my cut. Because they all came out there to see me get shot. And so they making the profit off of me about to get shot. So I said, man, you know some of that God's money. So I get out there. And sure enough, he shows up. I told the brother, I said, look, you open up, man. You open up, I'm going to watch. Because the Bible said, watch. I said, you open up. So he got there. And so I said, no, I'm going to open up. You're going to preach. I'm going to watch. I thought myself, I'm open up. I wind up preaching 2 hours straight. Holy Ghost drunk on me, I wind up preaching 2 hours straight. This is the third day. God promised me. He said, on the third day, Tracy, I am going to do a miracle.
All right.
Listen to God. I get out there, I'm looking. And all of a sudden, people that was coming, because it was in Crack Alley, people that was driving up to get the drugs, and driving up to do their business, start putting it down, walking up. Before I knew it, they had a humongous crowd out there. Wednesday had to live by faith. Since time we were married, you know. more in the latter than earlier years than now, because, you know, I mean, we had to believe for gas to get to church. Literally gas. You go to that car, you tell that car, you're going to get me to church now in the name of Jesus. Or you had enough to make it to church, but not to make it back. Before you get out of there, somebody that slips up on you. Yeah, brother, the Lord told me to get that down. I said, praise God, you heard from him. Supernatural turnaround. Supernatural turnaround. I'm trying to build your faith here. God wants to give you a supernatural turnaround. That's something that nobody else can do. Something that nobody else can do. I told God in the beginning of this year, and I told my congregation that I'm privileged to pastor, I said, I'm coming out of this year with what I never had before. I mean that I'm not coming out of this year the same way. There was something that birthed in my spirit. That I know that this is my season. I tell you to get a grip on God. Get a grip on God. I'm coming out of this. I want my mother to sing. I want the Lord have mercy. I'm coming out of this, but I never, and we were seeing these things, and things that have been strongholds for years, now breaking off.
All right. Uh-huh.
Because we dare to believe the impossible.
Yes.
All things are possible. And I want to say this, if what you're doing, that you can do on your own strength, educational talents,
all right.
Money, what you got in the bank, you ain't living a God kind of life. It's good that you can do it. But you're living below God's agenda.
Yes.
Because God wants in your life what only He can do.
Yes.
It's not your kids, not your family, it's not your wits. You know you ain't that smart. You said you can be able to testify God did that.
Yes.
You know the plans that you have for us, plans to prosper us, most of us, to bring us to an expected end. So then, God, we give you permission.
Yes.
We open our hearts and invite you, Father, to have your way in our lives. Up to this point, we've been reserved. Now, God, we ask that you would break down every barrier, every wall, and meet us. I see God doing some things in here at the point of our need. Let this word go in. Let this word go into our hearts and bring forth a harvest. Thank you for the meeting place, the pastor, the leaders. Pagan, Pastor Cross, thank you for the leaders of this house. Thank you for the heart of God in this house.
Right.
I ask that you release such an anointing that will break the back of the enemy in all of their endeavors. I don't believe that it's over with, God. I believe that you're just getting started, that the latter shall be greater than the former. Some of the things that you're waiting on is about to be over. But in this season here, the Lord is covering you. And you have now, you have a greater spirit of discernment upon you. And you shall go forth and do great things in God. Hallelujah. And there shall be a new anointing rest upon you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. That shall break the back of the enemy. Hey, Lord. Concerning some personal, intimate things, God says, I heard you. And I will do it, said God, because I am pleased with you. Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise for that. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You know, it's amazing that y'all can be friends and cousins in the natural and be, but there's something that goes beyond that. Y'all connected in the spirit. Y'all connected. And there's a dynamic dual thing. It's going to come to a place where y'all ministering. That one going to jump up for the other one. And they're not going to tell where one stopped at and where one began. That's the spirit that shall be upon you. And the spirit of God shall use you mightily. Divine healing, God has promised you. He has promised you to do divine healing. And divine healing shall now flow. Shall flow in your ministry in a greater way. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Now hear the Lord saying eagle eyes. That's eyes to discern and to see prophetically and to support this ministry. There's some things that you're going to see even in governmental issues that God's given you the privilege to be able to pray about and to bring those things or to cast down those things and bring those things into fruition. For the Lord says he do nothing in this earth realm without a prophet revealing it to his prophet. And so then the Lord has honored you with that anointing. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Praise God. Yeah, they're going to say, how come such a powerful man come from a small place? But God has called you.
Yes.
Your wife also, as I looked upon her last night, has a word in her mouth. And she's kind of sitting back right now, but I'm telling you, the season shall come where it shall change upon her. And she shall speak the word of God with power and great boldness. Hallelujah. Praise God. Come here, brother, please. Hold your hand. Yes, ma'am. You, sister, I remember. Praise God. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord. Decisions. Decisions. Plenty of decisions. I hear God saying, there's decisions that you have to make. And they have been a struggle for to see some of the things that you need to understand where it's going in your life. And so then now is the time of releasing. Oh my God. I see areas of relationship struggles. Deception. Hallelujah. But God, at this season, has given you a greater discernment. Praise him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Glory to Jesus. What you do for that?
I'm a teacher.
You're a teacher also. So your mother was a teacher. I guess once a teacher, always a teacher. Even in this day and age, I see whispering behind your back. But God's going to use you to glorify him. And there's been some held back stuff from you that shall be revealed. And it's going to have to be released to you for which yours is yours, said God. Amen. I'm talking in the area of positional and recognition. But it shall come out of you new and more creative ideas that it shall enhance your place. You intend to go to the administration portion of this?
Yes, I'm getting my master's right now.
Yes. She's getting her master's right now. I see you coming up with ministrational ideas and creativity that's going to enhance the place. God says, I made you a leader, not a follower.
Feeling free to talk to them. Honor your leadership.
y'all go, you miss it again, and go, my
Hallelujah.
She got the book.
Hallelujah.
All right. This is an avenue that God's going to use. I want you to take your book, and if you haven't been doing it already, I want you to take it with you in prayer and speak. Remember, the writer said, he said, Lord, I pray that there's a door. Pray for me that a door of utterance is open unto me.
Yes.
And I want you to pray that prayer over that book and say, Lord, I pray that through this book a door of utterance will be open unto me to give you the glory.
Yeah.
And not only will that happen, but it's going to be very profitable.
Hallelujah.
Oh, I heard something.
Hallelujah.
Women,
Hallelujah.
Get your mammograms.
Hallelujah.
Get your mammograms.
Hallelujah.
Yes, that's proper.
Yeah.
Get your mammograms. Check yourself so you know where to direct your faith.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Check yourself so you know where to direct your faith.
Yeah.
I was stupid for many years. Wife said, Jason, you need to go to die. You need to go to die. You need to go to die. Find out. We get facts and apply to get faith.
Yes.
We need to know where to direct our faith. Yes. It makes it easier when you know where to direct your faith.
Oh.
People think faith out there just hanging out in the way. No, faith is a knowledge base. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. It has somewhere to go. It has a foundation to it.
It's good.
God's good.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I ain't finished, but I'm going to stop. Thank God for you and your time.
Amen.